So, hi everyone. I'm Shreya Anand. I'm a third year graduate student from California Institute of Technology, and I work with Mansi Kasliwal on searching for electromagnetic counterparts to gravitational waves. And so thank you so much to Sara and to the Granma collaboration for having me today. And I'll be talking to you today about searching for kilonovae with growth during LIGO's third observing run. So I'll go through a little bit of background and motivation to start. So during LIGO's third observing run, known as O3, there were several different compact binary merger candidates that were detected. Most of these were binary black hole mergers, but there were a few binary neutron star and neutron star black hole mergers as well. So binary neutron star and neutron star black hole mergers are expected to produce electromagnetic radiation that is detectable with ground-based optical telescopes. And so you can see that the events span a wide range of luminosity distances, as well as a wide range of localization spanning from 100 square degrees to 1,000 square degrees, very well localized to very coarsely localized. And another striking feature of this plot, which was made by Michael Coughlin, is the position of this very large blue circle here. So GW17817, which was detected in August 2017, 2 years before the LIGO's third observing run, was a prolific multi-messenger event that was detected in gravitational waves and lit up the entire electromagnetic spectrum from gamma rays all the way to the radio. As you can see that this event was both very well localized and at a very close distance. And compared to 17817, we found ourselves in a surprise when we saw how distant the rest of the O3 population was and how coarsely localized it actually was. So there are many models that describe the geometry and composition of the optical and near-infrared transient that's associated with the gravitational wave event known as a kilonova. So these kilonovae are known to synthesize R process elements, which include gold, europium, lanthanides, and actinides, and many other elements. So what I'm showing here is a diagram from Dan Kaysen from 2017. Here he has mapped out the geometry of a kilonova event for different merger and remnant scenarios. So in a case when you have two neutron stars merging, you could end up with a long-lived neutron star remnant, or you could end up with a prompt collapse to a black hole. And this would result in a different composition of the disk wind ejecta. So here, the blue regions correspond to light R process element generation, known as lanthanide free. And the red regions correspond to lanthanide rich heavy R process element generation. So you get different scenarios assuming a remnant that is a long lived neutron star versus a black hole. And on the other hand, when you have a neutron star and a black hole merging, you'll end up with a black hole remnant with a single tidal tail that is ejected. So typically, the resulting light curve would be much redder for a neutron star black hole event as compared to neutron star event, where you expect a fast fading blue component to the light curve. So that's what's shown here. So this is both models of a binary neutron star kilonova shown with the data from GW17817. So some characteristic features include a very fast fading blue component to the light curve, which corresponds to the lanthanide free ejecta, and a longer lived red and near infrared component, which corresponds to the lanthanide rich heavy element generation. And this is important when we're trying to understand more about kilonovae in the, or more about the rates and R process yield from neutron star mergers. So there have been several studies trying to probe the both the rates of R process events in the Milky Way, as well as the yield from neutron star mergers. And these are probed through different channels. So you can see that there is one of the channels is measuring the amount of plutonium in the deep sea, which gives us some clues about heavy element deposits in on the Earth. Another channel is through asteroids or meteorites. We can measure heavy element presence in those. So that helps us with both rates and abundance. And we can also look at this from the perspective of potential kilonova models, which suggest that the R process yield is between 0.01 msun and 0.1 msun. So we can, so this leaves us with a region of uncertainty in which, in that is allowable in this parameter space. And so we can really get to the heart of the answer of this question. What is the rate of R process yield, and what is the amount that is ejected from each merger? We can really get at this, get at the answer of this question by detecting more kilonovae. There are many other science cases, including measuring the equation of state of a neutron star, constraining the Hubble constant. I could go on and on, but I'm choosing to highlight one of the science cases that is one of my favorites. So now I'll talk about the follow-ups that were performed with GROTH. So GROTH is the global relay of observatories watching transients happen. This is a global collaboration of astronomers across the world and a global coordination of observatories. So effectively, we place observatories all around the world, very similar to GRANMA, in order to beat sunrise so that we don't lose a single night of observations. And we can trade off duties when we are monitoring transients because we have people who are living all around the world. So I'll highlight one of the advantages of being part of this global collaboration, which is shown in our follow-up of the event S190426C. So this sky map spanned two hemispheres, and we observed it with several wide field observatories at cadence epochs. And we were able to cover much more probability with all of the wide field images combined than we would have just with one of them. Unfortunately, of course, the localization shifted, and so the probability remained in the Northern Hemisphere, but this demonstrates the power of using multiple wide field imagers located around the world in order to perform our observations. So as I mentioned, there are different imagers for discovery that we use. The main ones that we used were the Zwicky Transient Facility, which is a survey telescope that surveys the entire northern sky every three nights. It has a median limiting magnitude of 20.5, though we typically go deeper for the target of opportunity observations. And the main characteristic here, this is the reason why we call it a discovery engine, is because it has a field of view of 47 square degrees. So you can see for context, the location, the spiral galaxy within one pointing of ZTF. On the other hand, we have we had access to DECAM. So DECAM has a limiting magnitude of 24, far more sensitive than ZTF, but it has a 2.5 square degree field of view and a fast cadence. So you can see how these two imagers are very complementary and can be used to perform different kinds of follow-ups. Oh, and ZTF is located in Palomar, California, in the Northern Hemisphere, whereas DECAM is located in Cerro Tololo, Chile, in the Southern Hemisphere. So as I mentioned earlier, the sky maps of these O3 events and the distances to these events were very large. So we really needed a way to optimize the observations that we performed, such that we were doing it in an efficient way. And the way we did this was through the Growth Target of Opportunity Marshall. This is a database that automatically ingests GCNs from gravitational wave, gamma ray burst, and neutrino alerts. So ingests the sky maps, displays them on a page. Then we can plan our observations. We can import many different parameters and submit plans. And then that's ported over to the gravitational wave electromagnetic optimization code known as GWEMOPT. And I'm sure many of you are familiar because grandma also uses GWEMOPT. So GWEMOPT optimizes the tiling, scheduling, and time allocation within our sky maps. And then we get the resultant sky maps. We can trigger the observations through the Marshall, and we get summary observations and the transients that were detected within the sky map. So it's a very powerful utility during O3, and Michael and others are working actively on improving this Marshall so that we are ready for O4. So during O3 with the Zwicky Transient Facility, we covered 13 gravitational wave events. And as I mentioned, with the large localizations, we had the median localizations of these events was 4,500 square degrees, and the median distance was 267 megaparsecs. With ZTF, we managed to cover a median and close probability of about 40% and reach a median depth of 20.8 mags. You can see the sky maps shown on this figure here, covered with our ZTF tilings for some of the events. But one advantage with ZTF is that we were actually able to reduce the time latency to observation. 7 out of the 13 events were actually observable within 4 hours since the merger. So we had a good chance of detecting the fast blue optical emission that is expected of a kilonova. So of these 13 gravitational wave follow-ups that we performed, there were some of them that were particularly exciting and later verified by LIGO. And so I'll highlight these. So the first of them was GW190425. That was the first potentially EM bright event of O3, and also ended up being the second confirmed binary neutron star event. Very interesting event, even from the LIGO perspective. Then came the first high significance neutron star black hole candidate, which was GW190814, which was followed up by the DES-GW collaboration, and we analyzed the results. And the other two that were high significance came in January 2020, S200105AE and S200115J. And we've also analyzed the results of those observations, and I'll talk about that. But before I get to that, let me mention about transient vetting, which is a very important part of our selection of potential kilonova candidates. So let me start with the punchline, which is that no kilonova were found. Not by growth, not by grandma, not by any collaboration, which is a bit of a disappointment. However, within our 13 gravitational wave follow-ups, we had 2 million alerts, and these were reduced to 2,200 candidates that we could then vet manually after a transient filtering process, which is a basic process that ensures that the candidates are real, not stellar, astrophysical, and hopefully extragalactic. And then we apply some kilonova rejection criteria, which I'll talk about, that reduce this 127 candidates down to zero kilonovae. And the 127 we get after doing human vetting, manual inspection of images, just checking, doing some basic checks to see if the transient is potentially interesting. So this step of rejecting kilonova imposters is a critical step. And it involves firstly checking whether the transient of interest is excluded by location. But then after that, the quickest way to reject a potential candidate is by taking a spectrum. So you'd think that we might do this for every candidate. Of course, the limitation is that we have limited facilities, and we also have some very fast fading transients that we're unable to get spectra of. So the main criteria that we used throughout was photometric rejection criteria. We imposed a cut of 0.3 mags per day evolution for the transient for it to be considered interesting. This is informed by our knowledge of kilonova models. And finally, there were some kind of transients that escaped our initial vets that ended up being asteroids or artifacts that appeared very closely to mimic a kilonova-like event. So I'll highlight one particular candidate, which made us very excited at the beginning because of its beautiful decay here within the first few days. A spectrum quickly revealed that this was not the type of transit we were looking for, but it ended up being an untriggered GRB afterglow at Z of 1.26. So it was definitely a treasure, but not the treasure that we were looking for. So what do we do in the face of non-detection? I'll talk a little bit about constraints that we can place on the kilonova population. So as I mentioned earlier, the DESGW collaboration followed up the neutron star black hole merger GW190814, and they performed extensive observations lasting 7 days with the I and Z band. And the DECAM growth collaboration and the DESGW collaborations have an agreement that anyone who observes any gravitational wave event first will release the data so that it's available to analyze for both teams. And so that's what we did. We analyzed their observations. We found that their median limits were able to rule out many of the potential models for kilonova emission. And here we use models from Mattia Bulla. And these constraints correspond directly to constraints on the ejecta mass and cosine theta obs parameter space. So you can see a large portion of the allowed region is ruled out depending on what distance assumption you take to be, and depending on phi, which is the half opening angle of the lanthanide-rich component of the kilonova. And you can also see that a GW170817 like kilonova would be ruled out given an optimistic distance assumption. However, the big caveat is that LIGO has since published a paper showing that this event is most likely a binary black hole merger, or if it's an NSBH merger, it's probably an extreme mass ratio NSBH merger from which we would not expect any kilonova emission. However, we can apply the same methodology to an event that's more promising. So that's what we did for these two January NSBH mergers. And we found, unfortunately, we were hit with some bad luck because O5AE had a very large sky map, and 15J, we were hit with some bad weather. So we were unable to place good constraints with the median limiting magnitudes. However, we went through an exercise to see what is possible with ZTF. So we took the deepest ZTF limiting magnitudes on each night. And we saw what constraints could be possible on these models. What can we learn? And we found that just with observations reaching 22nd magnitude, which is quite within reach for any meter class observatories, we can actually place meaningful constraints on the kilonova emission for events as far as 283 megaparsecs. And here you'll notice that the kilonova models for NSBH mergers are different from the previous slide. And that's because Mattia Bulla has constructed, had by then constructed an updated grid of neutron star black hole merger kilonovae that had two components, a wind and a dynamical component, and showed basically that these kilonova models are far more long lasting compared to the BNS kilonova models. And so these constraints on the light curve emission translate directly to constraints on the ejecta mass and the observer angle parameter space that then translate to constraints on the source property. So with deep enough observations, can actually place strong constraints on large neutron star radii, low mass ratios, and highly aligned black hole spins in the event of non-detection. But a more robust way to do this, instead of using the median limiting magnitudes on each night, would be to synthesize all of the pointings that we performed during the time that we observed that sky map. And so we used the survey simulator software, SimSurvey, and we performed injections of kilonovae. Here we assume a top hat model where the kilonova peaks at a given absolute magnitude and stays at the same brightness for 3 days. And we do this for all of the GW events that we followed up. And we get, so we inject them and we calculate the, we get the recovery efficiency from the survey simulation. And we can translate the efficiencies of each event by multiplying the P, where P is the efficiency. We multiply together 1 minus P for each of the events, for each absolute magnitude, and we can get a joint non-detection probability for all 13 events that is a function of the peak absolute magnitude. So we find that if all kilonovae peaked at an absolute magnitude of about minus 16, our joint non-detection probability is 4.2%. But we have to take into account decay rates. I mean, there's no kilonova without a decay rate. So we perform this exercise again, and we say, okay, if all kilonovae peaked at minus 16.6 and faded at 1 mag per day, like 17, the joint non-detection probability would be 7% with ZTF. But there's another caveat, which is that we can't, just like for any transient, we can't expect that the entire population is uniform. We have to, we do have to expect that there's some kind of diversity in the peak absolute magnitude and decay rate. So we can instead say, okay, so if we assume that a given fraction of kilonovae peak at absolute magnitudes between minus 10 and minus 20, then we can constrain the luminosity function of kilonovae. So that's what we do. And we can report at a given confidence level that that fraction using the efficiencies that we get from our SimSurvey simulations. So we generate these curves for different assumptions, fading 1 mag per day, or for a flat kilonova, or for using different radiative transfer models. And we say that no more than 57% or 89% of kilonovae could be brighter than minus 16.6 mag, assuming a flat or a fading evolution. So this does have some caveats, which is that we assume, for these numbers at least, we assume that all of the events are astrophysical, which is later was later shown not to be true. We had to assume given decay rates in order to place constraints on the luminosity function. So that's where our future work can come in. We can improve over this methodology. So one thing in particular I'll talk about is this recent work, which is led by Siddharth Mohite. So he built a code for hierarchical Bayesian inference of kilonova properties that our team has gotten a chance to collaborate with him and the group at UW Milwaukee on this code. And so the idea here is that you can parameterize kilonovae by their initial absolute magnitude and their decay rate. And you can jointly infer the non-detection probability of a kilonova with a given M naught and alpha within the gravitational wave sky map based on the based on all of the observations that were performed. So what you can see here is one example of a corner plot that was produced by the code showing the most likely kilonova, most likely model here that has the most support with a given M naught and an alpha based on the observations. Can also draw from a set of astrophysical priors that would reduce the parameter space effectively. And it's pretty trivial to then do this for multiple events and combine the results together. So we're hoping to use this during O4. So yes, what can we do to prepare for LIGO's next observing run? As I mentioned, this is one of the efforts that is being worked on. But we can also strive towards kilonova detection by building optical and near-infrared facilities with deeper sensitivity. We can improve the existing kilonova models for analysis, optimize scheduling, and prepare more realistic observing scenarios. We can conduct serendipitous searches for kilonova candidates using the data stream. And we can simulate and assess survey performance such that we may not even have to trigger target of opportunity observations. So looking forward, this is a slide that Sarah specifically asked me to speak about. And so in the context of broader multi-messenger astrophysics, how does our work fit in? So our team has worked extensively on refining strategies for searching for kilonovae based on their expected luminosities, the distances to the events, and the sky areas that we hope will be useful going forward. We have prepared some image processing pipelines for real-time kilonova identification. So specifically, we are developing this code. Michael and Igor Andrioni are leading this effort to create a pipeline known as ZTF-REST, which employs force photometry and stacking in real time to identify fast transients in the ZTF data stream. And as I mentioned, frameworks for analyzing non-detections. But there are many big challenges here. One of them is how do we distinguish between real GW events and false alarms, just given the limited information we have? And moreover, how do we decide whether a sky map is too large, whether the event is too distant for it to be worth conducting all of these follow-ups? So that's something worth thinking about. Also, we need good, robust ways of weeding out kilonova imposters from the data stream. And we need to get more insight about the wide diversity of kilonova models that currently exist. And finally, there are many long-term impacts for multi-messenger astrophysics, including the building of deeper IR-sensitive telescopes that also are beneficial for fast transient identification. And furthermore, we can understand more about the rates, the host environments, and population properties of kilonovae and of NS mergers if we detect more kilonovae. And finally, we can use the information that we have gained from our follow-ups and from our detections to address fundamental questions, such as the tension between Hubble constant, the equation of state of neutron stars, and our process nucleosynthesis. So thank you so much for listening, and I look forward to hearing your questions. Thank you.